Good morning and welcome to Ireland AM on Virgin Media One. It's Sunday, the 20th of November, just in case you're checking. Anyway, we've got a jam-packed show for you today.
Coming up, we'll be taking a look at the front of this morning's newspapers, including details that the budget for housing is still unspent as crisis grows throughout the country.
In sport, we'll review Ireland's extremely tight match against Australia last night and look ahead to the drama-filled World Cup as it kicks off today.
We'll be getting a ballet masterclass from two of the leads of this year's production of The Nutcracker. Now, I hope yourself and Katia know your pirouettes from your pliés, because I ain't doing it.
Pliés, don't make me do it. Pliés, for the sake of the nation.
I can't believe
they don't need
there.
To see me ballet dancing. Really, you don't. Anyway, from starring in Netflix The Witcher to landing a role in a new Netflix series, Dublin actor Niamh McCormack will be dropping by.
And we'll be joined by iconic reggae band UB40, who have sold over 100 million records worldwide and enjoyed a career spanning an impressive 5 decades. You're going to be singing Red, Red Wine.
There's
for the
a
next...
rat in my kitchen. What am I going to do this? Oh.
Can't Here we go. I'm in for a morning of it.
Anyway, Katia, what are you up to?
Martin, I hope you've been stretching out for your pliés. Good morning, guys. Also coming up, we've got French Madeleines for breakfast and party styles on the catwalk. I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm party season ready with what we've had this weekend. So what about you guys?
A party season ready. You'd be great between UB40 and pirouetting around the studio. We'd be flying from the parties.
This is the only stretch that I can manage. First thing on a Sunday morning.
Oh, unless you wait till later on, sir. We'll be having the crack and I'll be laughing at you anyway. But for now, we'll check on the news you're waking up to today with Hannah Murphy.
Thank you and good morning. Well, the COP27 Climate Change Summit has finally approved an historic deal to create a fund to compensate the nations most at risk of extreme weather. Applause broke out in Egypt as nations came to an agreement on loss and damage payments to support vulnerable countries. The talks were extended into yesterday as delegates struggled to make a breakthrough. While it's seen as a big win for the countries who will feel the worst impacts of rising temperatures, the summit has faced criticism for not being more ambitious when it comes to reducing emissions.
A fund for loss and damage is essential, but it's not an answer if the climate crisis washes a small island state off the map or turns an entire African country to desert. The world still needs a giant leap on climate ambition. The red line we must not cross is the line that takes our planet over the 1.5 degree temperature limit. To have any hope of keeping to 1.5, we need to massively invest in renewables and end our addiction to fossil fuels.
Leo Varadkar has told the Fine Gael Ardesh that there is not a chance that he would consider going into government with Sinn Féin. The Taoiseach also praised Fianna Fáil leader Micheál Martin for the work he has done in his role as Taoiseach. In the years that Fine Gael has been in government, it has faced multiple criticisms about the handling of a deepening housing crisis. Speaking in Athlone last night, Leo Varadkar admitted the party must do much more to improve home ownership levels.
I know we need to do so much more in housing. We need to implement and accelerate housing for all. And whenever I meet young people and even not so young people, I'm often asked the same question. Will I ever have a chance to own my own home? Is there light at the end of the tunnel? Should I give up and go abroad? We will make it our mission to restore that element of the social contract and make home ownership affordable for the many again.
Almost a week after her death tonight, a special programme will pay tribute to the life of Vicky Phelan. Vicky Phelan, in her own words, will bring viewers through the hardships she faced as she fought for life-saving treatment, her role in the 221 Plus support group, and how she found happiness in even the toughest of times. The cervical cancer campaigner passed away last Monday at the age of 48.
But I remember it took me a day or two to kind of think. It went from kind of feeling sorry for myself and kind of panicking to kind of going, well, hang on a minute, maybe there is something, you know. And I got really angry and I thought, I'm going to start looking and see if there's anything else. Surely there must be something. And that was it. I was on the laptop.
Vicky Phelan, in her own words, airs on Virgin Media One tonight at 10:30. After months of controversy, the World Cup soccer tournament gets underway in Qatar today. The country has faced a litany of criticisms since it was chosen by FIFA to host the tournament, which lasts until next month. In a late decision on Friday, FIFA confirmed that alcohol sales will be banned in the 8 Qatar World Cup stadiums. In the US, a girl taking part in a Christmas parade in North Carolina has died after being hit by one of the trucks pulling a float. Witnesses at the parade in Raleigh told local media they heard the driver shouting that he had lost control of the vehicle and couldn't stop it before the crash. Police arrested a 20-year-old man and the parade was cancelled immediately after the incident. Sticking with the US, where a driving ban is being lifted in parts of New York State after a massive snowstorm brought cities to a standstill this week. Several feet of snow fell yesterday, with Buffalo suffering the heaviest fall. At least three people died and local airports were closed during the extreme weather. It's believed the worst of it hit yesterday.
So in the eastern, northern and western parts of the city, we will go from driving ban to travel advisory. The driving ban will remain in effect in South Buffalo because of how heavy the snow is in that part of the community.
New Twitter owner Elon Musk has said he will reinstate Donald Trump's account. The former president has been banned ever since a pro-Trump mob attacked Capitol Hill on January 6th in the aftermath of the 2020 election. Musk made the announcement after polling users, asking if the account should be restored. The yes vote won with just over 51% of the vote. And an international balloon festival has brightened skies across Mexico. More than 200 colourful hot air balloons from 20 different countries have been on display near the city of León in central Mexico. Authorities are expecting more than 400,000 visitors to attend the four-day festival. And now let's get a first look at your weather this Sunday morning.
For car insurance, van insurance or home insurance, call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning has already seen heavy showers across the country, which are expected to turn more scattered as we approach midday. Temperatures are ranging between 4 and 8 degrees. The afternoon will see some sunny spells with calm and clear skies by the early evening. Temperatures will range between 5 and 9 degrees. And tonight we'll see initially dry conditions with some more wet and breezy weather pushing up from the southwest as we approach morning, leaving a chance for spot flooding. Overnight temperatures will range between 3 and 7 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. Now let's check on your morning papers, starting with the Sunday Independent. The headline there reads, €476 million euro for housing still unspent as crisis grows. The paper reports that nearly €500 million of the government's housing budget for the first 9 months of this year was not spent. That's according to a secret memorandum given to ministers last week.
The Business Post opens with Ryan. Industry will have to pay for climate change damage, it writes on Eamon Ryan's new statement that businesses in highly polluting sectors such as fossil fuels and aviation should face new levies to pay for the global damage done by climate change.
Moving on to the tabloids now, the Irish Mail on Sunday opens on the headline, Cabinet fears over Russian poll meddling. The paper reports that ministers and government officials are employing increased security measures due to deepening fears of Russian infiltration.
The Sunday World opens on the headline, Road to Hell. It writes on the story about the story of Dale Fogarty, who robbed a car while a teenage girl was sitting in the back seat. Fogarty, of course, was since killed in a head-on crash, leaving the girl seriously injured.
And finally, the Mirror leads with caught offside. The paper states that a football fan who sparked an airport security alert after climbing over a security screening missed his flight to the Qatar World Cup and has been ordered to pay more than €1,000 to charity.
Ah, the craziness of it all. OK, up next, we take you through the top stories making today's papers.
See you after the break. You're very welcome back now from Ireland's growing housing crisis to Biden's 80th birthday. It's been a very busy morning for news, and here to chat through the top stories making today's papers is leadership communications expert and columnist with the Sunday Independent, Gina London, and Eoin Tomás McDermott from the Communications Clinic. Good morning to both of you. Thank you so much for joining us today. Now, I suppose we have to start off with the housing crisis today. How, in the name of all that's holy, is there 500 million? Is that half a billion?
Half a billion, yes.
Lying around, unspent, when half the country's homeless and houses aren't being built? But explain it to me in layman's terms, because I just don't know.
The thrust of this story, really, that there was a private memo went to Cabinet from Minister O'Brien to his ministerial colleagues saying that there was about half a billion euro not spent. Now, there also is mentioned, though, in the memo that there hope to be more spending in this quarter of the year, that a lot of activity happens towards the end of the year and that the hope is that more money will be spent. The reasons why the money hasn't been spent, they're saying things like supply chain, inflation leading to the increase of price around materials, for example, but also energy and fuel. They're also saying that there's staff shortages. And the specific areas where the money hasn't been spent is mostly around local authorities, where local authorities haven't spent the money that was allocated to them. Obviously, Eoin O'Brien from Sinn Féin is saying this is not a good enough reason, that for all of those reasons, in fact, that the money should have been spent and that there should be more money being spent because of inflation, not less money, but that there isn't really a definitive reason for this. Obviously, this is a huge challenge for government. It is a huge challenge for the state. Minister O'Brien, for example, is really in backing this, you would hope. And also he sees it, I think, as linked to his future, because Micheál Martin is going to step down as leader of Fianna Fáil at some point in the near future. And Dara O'Brien sees himself as a potential successor. He needs to have a success in this area. But judging by this, he's a bit away from that result so far.
Yeah, Gina.
Well, I think one of the things that was pointed out that you mentioned very well, but in addition to the opposition's concerns about, hey, this is a very reason why we need to be spending this money. And by the way, when you say in the last quarter, we're in the midway of the last quarter already. So
6 weeks
when
left,
is it going to happen? Exactly. And the point that Sinn Féin made that I think needs to be brought up is simplification of processes, the bureaucracy overhaul that is really desperately needed in the housing market. Having lived in the United States and bought a couple of homes there and now being here, it is an incredibly mired and Byzantine process to find a home, get that mortgage, get the inspection process, get to the end of the line on that. And that's a delay that could be overhauled with updated technology, getting systems in place that are simplified. And that's where some of that money should be being spent.
Even if it comes to like CPOs, or there's a lot of derelict houses around, we saw that in the last census, there's a lot of vacant properties. I mean, there seems to be a lot of ideas floating around, but no actual definitive action in doing it. You can plan all these things, like the People's Front of Judea or the James People's Front at this stage, just like talk as much as you want, but get things done.
Well, President Higgins sailed close to the wind in terms of what he's constitutionally allowed to talk about.
He's winning the American.
But also he said that if you want to solve the problem, you have to build state housing on state property,
which is true.
Which one could argue, because the ESRI, for example, had a report towards the end of October that said that rent prices the cost of rent had gone up by something like 84% in 9 years, which is hugely significant. They also said that that increase is pushing people closer to poverty than ever before. So that's hugely significant. The Irish Congress and trade unions, who are having a protest next Saturday, have said that housing is the most important issue for trade unions right now. That's staggering. You would have thought pay conditions would be important, but housing and homes is what the trade unions are caring about.
We have a teaching crisis problem. All half the doctors in the country are emigrating to Australia and New Zealand. And the main reason is they can't afford to live here, and if the life is so much better elsewhere, why would you stay? Especially if something as a basic need as housing isn't being looked after or catered for in any way, shape or form, apparently, but because it's not getting any better.
It's not, and the idea that is being expressed about the housing issue, and the idea that you can not have construction when you need construction, and you need to have when you talk about shortages of supplies of staff, there are people who want to work. How can this be continued to use as an excuse? I moved here 8 years ago, and the idea of a housing crisis was talked about a lot then. It hasn't gotten any better.
Gina, are you going to go back? Because I want to know now what the state is going
on.
No, that is
a very good question. I would not move back to the United States. And happy
birthday
to our president.
Happy birthday, Mr. Biden, today. Now, and Donald Trump, of course, this week announced his intention to run for 2024, the US presidential election. He's dissing DeSantis left, right and centre. What are the chances of this happening, Trump actually getting through? Are we looking at like a split in the Republican Party?
There's already a split in the Republican Party.
A big
let's
one.
Face it.
A chasm,
there might be a chasm. That could be. But what we're seeing now, of course, is that President Trump came out after his dismal appearances or results in the midterm elections, when almost all of his personally backed candidates did not make the mark in that midterm election. As is generally the case, the number of seats in the House were minuscule compared to what usually happens in a midterm race when there's it was very marked. Small. But so then he said he was going to make his big announcement. And interestingly, when he was at Mar-a-Lago on Tuesday making his announcement for the run in 2024, his daughter wasn't there. Mm. His son, one of the sons, Eric, was there, of course, still looking for that fatherly hug.
Daddy, love me. Please love me.
But it was very interesting. The speech was supposed to be 40 minutes. It was over an hour. People were trying to leave, and the security wouldn't let them leave. I mean, the tenor around him is much more muffled than before. Let's look at three things. Polling, popularity in polling, fundraiser, and policy. Let's skip policy because it's unexpected that Ron DeSantis or the governor of Florida, who's polling much higher, is going to be spending a lot of time in the primaries on the policy issues. But he is a traditional conservative in the sense, largest sense of the word. And of course, Trump is not going to be spending a lot of time on policy. It'll be more on the insults that we're already hearing of Ron Sanctimonious instead of Ron DeSantis. But if you look at their fundraising already, Governor DeSantis had an incredible win, over 20 points this year when he ran for governor against his challenger. So he's going way up in the polls. In the Republican Party, he's double digits ahead of Trump in New Hampshire, in Iowa, those first primary, primary states. And then when it comes to fundraising, he hasn't even officially put his name in the ring, and he's only $10 million behind Trump. So Trump lost the midterms. Trump lost 2020. It looks like he might be up for a triple. And don't forget, on another specter that's around the horizon, many of the critics say that Trump put his candidacy in this early because he hopes it will somehow help him avoid being indicted. All those investigations are going. And just this week, also, Attorney General Robert Mueller finally appointed a special counsel who was investigating war crimes in The Hague and now is flying into Washington to be the special counsel in the investigation ongoing of Donald Trump. So there's a lot going on.
There must be a lot. I can imagine Port of Vancouver. Dad, please, you're just embarrassing us now. Just please stop. And if she's not backing him, there's no hope.
Well, you see, it's interesting who's beginning to move against him or move away from him. For example, there was the Larry Hogan, who's the governor for Maryland, has said really that Donald Trump has lost the 2018, the 2020 and the 22 elections. Yeah. You also then have Mitch McConnell saying things like that Trump is becoming, you know, quite extreme. And Mitch McConnell is
to say that is kind of interesting.
But also he's saying that he's losing the wider appeal of the Republican Party for things like the more moderates and also then independent voters. You also see, though, the Murdoch media empire is starting to move against him again, who has been significant in his support. See, of the Wall Street Journal,
and
the New York Post all making these comments. So Trump is becoming
My very favorite thing with the New York Post when the day after his announcement, and there's this tiny little line on the front page that says, Florida man makes announcement. That's it.
It was on page 26.
That was the kicker when you go to 26. There was this little tiny column. I mean, worst thing for Donald Trump's ego is to not be mentioned. And until he goes to jail or goes away, he's going to be continuing to fight for the spotlight.
Do you think Biden will be able to push back DeSantis, so if it does go to that? I know it's a bit early to be talking about that, but, you know, he is pushing 80. His popularity is in the low 40s now still, which isn't the strongest.
If I'm going to make a prediction that Biden will not actually stand for the presidency. I know he wants to. Yeah. I know until he hears from two important people, his wife, Dr. Jill, and his sister, Valerie, are his top advisors. There in that innermost circle, I think there was a very clear call, subtly set by Nancy Pelosi, the House Speaker. She said, look, I'm 82. Time to go. Our new day is dawning. She and the other two leaders of the Democratic majority of the leadership said, we're going to hand it over to the next generation. I think that's a call for her.
Who is the next generation?
The 50-year-olds in Congress.
Difficult. There's no, like, there's Hakeem Jeffries, who's going to be the leader of the Democrats in the House.
The election's November 3rd.
He's New York.
He also is, you know, that again, but he doesn't have the weight, for example, that Nancy Pelosi would have had. So there's no necessarily direct successor like there was of the Obama era when he was the young senator who could bring people together. You also then have Kamala Harris, who didn't perform fantastically in 2020 and also hasn't had a stellar performance as vice president.
And she's a woman and she's black, that's going to be a problem.
Hakeem Jeffries won't be running for president, but there are a lot of people that are interested in their 40s and 50s who would be interested in running for president. So I think there's more to be seen.
And there's a lot more. We could talk about this all day, I know, being the political nerds that we are, but unfortunately we're after running out of time. Thank you so much, both of you, for joining us this morning, and I'm sure we'll have plenty to talk about on that very note the next time I see you as well. Now, after the break, we're looking back at some good news for a change, Ireland's victory in the rugby, and it's finally here, day one of the World Cup. Will you be watching it? I don't know. Don't go anywhere.
Back in Ireland, have done it again. Another win in the rugby for Andy Farrell's players, this time against Australia. And it's the event everyone's been talking about. The controversial Qatar World Cup is finally upon us. Well, joining me to help us get through all the major sporting stories is Anne-Marie Donlan from Off the Ball. But first, let's get a pick of the headlines. Run for the Hills is the headline in the back of the Sunday World. It's reported Manchester United are close to agreeing a deal with Cristiano Ronaldo that will end his time at the club. And the Sunday Independent go with Big Game Hunters. That's after Ireland's rugby stars rounded off a memorable year, which has seen them beast the Aussies, the All Blacks and the Springboks. And Anne-Marie, good to see you.
Hi, how are things?
All right. So they've done it. The three big teams from the Southern Hemisphere beaten this year, but not a great game last night.
Yeah, a memorable year, but definitely not a memorable night last night. Kind of felt like the game never really got going at all. There was no real spark to it. 3 points to no score at halftime. The first half particularly go down in the memory for anyone. But in terms of the game, we know that Sexton was ruled out in the warm-up, so it was Crowley who came in. Really good for him to get minutes. Obviously, Joey Carberry had been ruled out as well previous to the game. So really good for him to come in. And obviously, we saw there the Ross Byrne kick at the end of the game, you know, nerves of steel.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, I know it's a cliche, but clichés are there for a reason. Good teams win on nights when perhaps they don't deserve to, or perhaps they don't put in brilliant performances. And it was a night like that. Good to see Bundiaki as well there come back. It was him who got the try, come back from suspension. But as you say, a game that won't go down in the memory for too many people.
No, look, a good win. Australia, we expected a bounce from them. We thought this was going to be a high-scoring game.
Yeah, we did, yeah, and it really wasn't. It was Ireland's defence that kept them in the game. And as you say, we thought it was going to be high scoring, but it really, really wasn't. It was a game from both sides that there were just so many errors and so many mistakes. And unfortunately, with Ireland, it just always seems to come back to Sexton, and his loss was there to be seen. Ireland, I know it's simplistic to say, but they just play better when Sexton is on the field. You know, the standards are higher and he brings something to a game that just other players can't bring. Although Crowley did well, he isn't Johnny Sexton, and perhaps that will be a problem going into the World Cup next year. We know, obviously, time waits for no man, and if Sexton does get an injury or anything, it will be a problem, and his loss was there to be seen last night.
So wrap him in cotton wool until we get to the World Cup, because this has happened before, where the year prior to a World Cup, we've won Six Nations, we won a Grand Slam, or we won a Triple Crown, and then when the big tournament comes round.
Yeah, the movie generally goes that we peak the year before the World Cup, and then we get to the quarterfinal stage and it's a disaster. And that's how it's gone the last few terms. So perhaps this Autumn Nation series, it was three wins out of three, but there weren't three scintillating performances, you know. It wasn't the kind of rugby that we witnessed in the summer, free-flowing and expansive. So perhaps it's best that we're not going into this Six Nations prior to the World Cup with kind of too much of an elevation, you know. Perhaps it was a little bit of a reality check, those three games this November, because there are serious improvements that will need to be made in the Six Nations and then into the World Cup. So perhaps it's not too much of a peak. I know it's three wins, but it's not, we're not getting ahead of ourselves.
Yeah,
as Matt Williams said last night, a little bit of a reality check.
A scruffy win is still a win.
So a win is a win.
We'll take that. Just very quickly, before we leave the rugby, the concussion debate came again. Nick White, a lot of people believe that he should not have come back out.
Yeah, really uncomfortable viewing for kind of most people who witnessed it. He did clearly seem to stumble. He wasn't steady on his feet on two different occasions after being hit or taken two blows to the head, and then he came back on. Obviously, we'll have to wait to see the medical report, but as I say, it's uncomfortable viewing, and unfortunately, rugby is in a position now where its future, not necessarily in doubt, but there is a little bit of cloud over where the game is going in terms of concussion. You know, we've seen people after their careers, we've seen legal challenges being made, we've seen people suffer difficulties in their life after the game because of concussion, because of things that have happened, and because of perhaps steps that weren't taken to protect them. So players need to be protected for the future of themselves, but also the game. So it was uncomfortable viewing last night. Like I say, we'll have to see what the medics say, but yeah, it's not nice for anyone to see it.
We'll move on because The Republic of Ireland soccer team are playing their last game of the year against Malta tonight.
Glamorous, eh? Malta away.
Hey, listen, lucky them. They're in the sun. It's all right. But we need to get a performance and we need to get a win out of this.
Yeah, it's only a friendly, but it kind of feels like there's no such thing as a true friendly in this Stephen Kenny era, because there's just so much pressure. There's just so much talk about where the side is going, the manager in terms of his future, how long is he going to be there? And of course, we know March isn't that far away. It's only around the corner after Christmas. And the period between March and November, and possibly even shorter than that, depending how the first few games go in the qualification period, is D-Day. Yeah. And we know the next game after tonight is France.
Yeah.
So that's obviously massive. So tonight, it is important in terms of building confidence. They need to go out there, get a clean sheet, score goals and win the game. And like nothing else will be acceptable. It's Malta. They need to do this. You know, they should have beaten Norway or at least gotten a draw on Thursday night. Obviously, that was as well Norway without Haaland. We can only imagine what may have happened if Haaland had been there. It was another disappointing performance, we have to say, and it just kind of feels like, where is the side going? And you know, if we just got a good win tonight and got some confidence into it and go kick
makes
on
us believe
then
a little
towards
bit more.
March. Yeah.
We're not at the World Cup, but it does start today. It's been controversial from the time it was announced that they were getting a World Cup, but it starts this very day and still the controversies go on.
Yeah, and it's obviously difficult for, you know, football fans. The World Cup is kind of the peak of football every 4 years and we all love it and we get really into it and everyone loves the tournament. But it is difficult because there's just so much cloud over the build-up, rightly so. And it shouldn't be in Qatar. I think we can all agree on that. I wish so much that it wasn't for so many different reasons. And it's just depressing. But at the same time, it's football and we love it. And, you know, if you feel that you can't watch it, that's fine. But also, if you do want to watch it from a footballing perspective, that's OK too. You know, it's like everyone's conflicted in this. And it's hard to know.
Yeah, as they were in 2018, because we didn't believe... It shouldn't have gone to Russia either, but did. People said they weren't going to watch it. I was avoiding it.
Yeah.
Then Portugal played
Spain.
Turned
into a great tournament,
and it actually turned into a good football tournament.
Yeah. So hopefully we'll get good football, because everything else with it is so wrong. And there are narratives going into this that are really interesting. You know, obviously it's Messi's last dance with Argentina. I think you'd have to have a heart of stone not to want him to finally win a World Cup and to lift it. Brazil as well, so stacked with talent. And obviously Europe have kind of dominated the World Cup in the last few different terms. So it kind of feels like the balance is shifting back over to South America. Brazil probably do have the most quality. But then as well, you can't totally rule out France. We know that Benzema has been ruled out this morning. That's a massive blow for them. This year's Ballon d'Or winner, we saw him practically win the Champions League on his own. You know, he can take a tournament and win it. But they're also still stacked with so much talent, France. So they'll be going there to try and defend their title.
Yeah, and yeah, I know, which hasn't been done for a long time. Mm-hmm. 1962 was the last time defending champions managed to hold on to their crown. Good to see you, Anne-Marie.
Thank you.
She has to watch the World Cup because that's her job.
I have to, yes. There's my excuse.
All right, cheers. Up next, we're practicing our pliés and pirouettes. with a ballet masterclass. Wish me luck. I'm gonna need to do a lot of stretching during this break. We'll see you in a few minutes. They say you can't teach an old dog new tricks, and today we're actually going to prove that that's absolutely right.
Mm-hmm. So joining us now to teach us some ballet moves, we have the brilliant Will Chester and Grace Sweeney from the Irish National Youth Ballet, who were good enough to stop by between rehearsals for their upcoming performance of the Nutcracker.
Yeah, now, footage of this year's dance is strictly under lock and key, so let's take a look at last spring's rendition of Cinderella. They cut it just before I came on.
I know.
I missed your literally part. Pirouetted on.
I'm literally wearing the skirt from last year. Like, come on.
I'm, a bit I'm of favouritism going on here. She got a costume, I didn't.
Well, do you know what? My dancing dreams were crushed, so that's why I am living vicariously through you guys. So tell us, how long have you both been dancing for?
I've been dancing since I was three.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
I've been dancing since I was 2 and a half.
So you're slightly ahead. You're both the same age, aren't you?
Yeah.
Okay. And is the aim to be a professional dancer? Is that the plan, Will?
Yeah.
By the way, we have to point out we have Will and Grace on the show today.
Will and Grace?
No, it's a big deal for us. Yeah. Will and Grace. It's great to have them here. And Grace, is that the aim for you, to be a professional dancer?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
It's incredible. Follow. Yeah. So then, the Nutcracker. Now you've auditioned back in May. Tell us what that audition process was like.
So it's like a ballet class, kind of.
Okay.
So, like, you start in the bar and then you move into the centre and stuff. So.
And was it really competitive? Like, were you eyeing out your competition? Or were you like, I've got this in the bag?
There was lots of different groups when we were auditioning, so we just kind of kept to ourselves.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's point work for the girls too. Oh.
Okay. What you're trying to find out, was there a bit of sledging going on?
I want to know that. It really is out there.
Anyway, what part are you playing in the Nutcracker?
I'm playing the prince in the Nutcracker.
Oh, wow, okay.
And that's your leading role. So you've actually been in the Nutcracker a couple of times. How many times have you been in the
I've
Nutcracker?
Done Nutcracker 4 times. This is my fifth one, yeah.
And it's your first leading role. That's amazing. High five for that. That is class.
That is cool. That is really
And you're
really
the cool. Sugar Plum Fairy.
Yeah.
Which I know is a bit more demanding. Like, it's a difficult role.
Yeah, a lot to do.
Yeah, a lot to do, yeah. So how's the training been like so far for you guys?
We've been training since August, so... Every Saturday we go and train our roles, so it's demanding.
Okay, so where do you train? Where do you and is there a bit of distance between home and training for you guys?
So we have our like home studios where we train. So I train at Coastal Ballet School.
And I train at Chess Scuba Dance.
And then on Saturdays we go. Yeah.
And the show's gonna happen in the Helix.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's early December, yes?
Yeah, December 8th, 9th and 10th.
Okay, and that's only a couple of weeks away from
it.
The countdown is seriously, seriously
I wonder off. If you were playing any Christmas tunes back in August to get you in the zone for this. It's really Christmas, like it's set on Christmas Eve, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a very magical feeling.
It's a great, great story. I, of course, was turned into a movie more recently. Sugar Plum Fairy isn't who we thought she was. There's a bit of an edge to the Sugar Plum Fairy.
Yeah, a little bit. Like in the first act, she's a party entertainer, and then she comes on in the second act and is Sugar Plum Fairy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Bit of a badass.
I know. Yeah. I want to learn some badass moves now.
Really?
Should we try? Oh. Are you going to show us?
Will and Grace are two lovely people. I think we should just keep talking to them.
See, they have it in them. They've come here to teach. We have this bar. I've got the skirt on, Martin. Come on. Let's live my dream right now of being a ballet dancer.
Oh.
Right, what are you going to show us first?
So we're going to show you a grand plié first. So
that sounds difficult.
So put your feet in first, so like turn your like toes out kind of.
Okay.
And bring your arm into first and second, and then just go.
To hold the bar, Martin.
Hold the bar.
Yeah.
So I've got my feet have to be pointing towards Kerry and Derry, and somebody help me up.
And are your heels allowed to lift off?
Yeah, like a tiny bit.
Okay.
Oh, I can't. You can lift your heels. So hang on.
All the way down.
And heels up.
There we go. Okay, and what's next?
I'm going to show you Devapé. So you start in fifth.
A what?
Fifth. Oh, hang on a sec.
Okay. This is fifth. Okay.
Yeah. And you bring the arm to first, and you extend the leg.
Ah, oh, come
Wait,
on.
Wait, no, I'm not here. Do that again for us. Just do that again for us there.
Okay, so one leg here, one leg here.
And then you bring it up to your tier and extend.
You're showing up.
I need to find out what hospital is on call.
Where
Elaine Crowley's over there with the phone right now. I'm using my hand just to get my leg up that far.
You gotta hold it up here. We're allowed stabilizers. Woo! There we go.
That's it. That's as far as we're getting.
Okay, and you have one more. Martin, you can do the last one.
So this is a grand bat. This is a grand bat one, so put your feet in.
Again!
And bring it out in second.
And bring the arm out.
Wow.
Here.
Wow.
That's it.
Yes.
Hang on, I have to get the arm moving first. I'm starting to get into this.
I'm trying not to get kicked in the face here.
Yeah. They're well out of range. So hang on, arm out.
So, 8 seconds.
Yeah.
I mean, impeccable form, Martin.
Tell you what,
I'm impressed.
The Nutcracker might have a new prince. I hate to say this. It could be under threat for you. This is the best thing I can do at this bar.
Honestly.
It's the only thing I can do.
But it is pretty challenging, do you find, like, because you've been training since you were so little.
Yeah.
So is it just, like, second nature now? Like, you don't really feel it as much as a challenge?
Yeah, we're just improving all the time to get them better.
It's incredible what you do, and to have been doing it so long and to be in this great production, testament to the work that you're putting in. So, Will and Grace, good luck in the Nutcracker.
Congrats.
It's running at the Helix, remember. That's where you can see it from the 8th until the 10th of December. You can visit the Irish National Ballet, the Irish National Youth Ballet website at inybco.com for more information.
Yeah, lots more to come on IrelandAM. We'll take a quick break.
Now let's check on your morning paper, starting with the Sunday Independent. The headline there reads, €476 million for housing still unspent as crisis grows. The paper reports that nearly €500 million over the government's housing budget for the first 9 months of the year was not spent, according to a secret memorandum given to ministers last week.
The Business Post opens with Ryan. Industry will have to pay for climate change damage, it writes. That Eamon Ryan's new statement that businesses in highly polluting sectors such as fossil fuels and aviation should face new levies to pay for the global damage done by climate change.
Onto the tabloids in the Irish Mail on Sunday opens on the headline, Cabinet fears over Russian poll meddling. The paper reports that ministers and government officials are employing increased security measures due to deepening fears of Russian infiltration.
The Sunday World opens on the headline, Road to Hell, and tells the story of Dale Fogarty, who robbed a car while a teenage girl was sitting in the back seat. Fogarty was since killed in a head-on crash, leaving the girl seriously injured.
And finally, the Mirror leads with caught offside. The paper states that a football fan who sparked an airport security alert after climbing over a security screening missed his flight to the Qatar World Cup and has been ordered to pay more than €1,000 to charity.
All right, that's your papers.
You've got some interesting news for us this morning.
I do have good news. So, do you know Bumble, the women-led dating app, comes out with research every year predicting dating trends. So they have come out with dating trends for 2023.
Okay.
Overall, it's very positive. They say a lot of people, 70% of people, are feeling very optimistic about dating in the new year. But one of these trends is called open casting. So this means that...
That sounds a bit dodgy.
I know. But basically, people are going to be more open to, like, who their type is. You know, everyone says tall, dark, handsome. What about shorter and dreadlocks or ginger and, you know, pretty on the inside? Do you know what I mean?
Are you talking about be open to pugnacious people and don't be so shallow on dating apps? Is that what you're trying to say?
Sometimes I think people are really shallow on these dating apps because it is image-based. So, yeah, so we've open casting with 38% people more likely
to
go.
So is that just like a Russian roulette? So you just like...
Almost.
Phew.
Yeah, wow, literally.
Okay. It's just open casting in brackets. I'm now desperate. So, yeah.
You know what? I don't think... I feel like people haven't found the right one because maybe they've just been looking within
We haven't really... dating app, have we? Obviously, no, because you're happily married.
Well, I found my partner on a dating app.
Yeah.
I found him on Tinder, and this was years ago, but it was very much like you just swipe and you look at someone, you're like, oh, are they nice or whatever, and then you text and then you date them. But it is hard
to
do.
Hang on a second now. What was your criteria for all your open casting channel? I've seen you're a fella and he's an open casting
I said to Lane earlier, my criteria was like, you need to be taller than 6'3".
Not 6'4", 6'3".
6'3". Yeah. And a super, and like a pretty boy, but... You need to have intellect and be intelligent and cultured.
So you kind of wanted it all.
So I had, yeah.
And you kind of pretty much got
well,
it.
I feel like we should be picky, but also should be open to meeting different people, people outside of like who we think
but
is attractive.
Basically, if it's not working so far, just broaden your horizon.
But come here, with the pandemic and everything, we have another trend called wander love because a lot of people are working from home, a lot of people are more flexible, and you've got 14% of people that are more of digital nomads, so they're open to dating someone outside their city, outside their country even.
So you don't have to see them very often. That sounds like a great plan.
And I do wonder, like, text us, let us know if you have met, like, the love of your life abroad or if you've maintained a successful relationship, like, long-distance relationship. But this one really did catch my eye, the dating renaissance, OK?
Oh, right.
Right. So, again, in over the last few years with COVID and everything, a lot of people have, you know, been divorced, broken up with lifelong partners. So you've 39% of people that are brand new to dating apps and to Bumble. Right. And they're basically going to be exploring and navigating how online dating works and meeting people through Bumble, which I think is great because it can be really daunting.
Explain Bumble compared to other apps for us, those who don't know.
Bumble is women-led, so the woman can send the message first, whereas...
The fella can't.
The fella can't.
At all.
Exactly. So you won't be having any abuse or, like, dodgy comments. Like
dodgy pictures or anything
like that. Dodgy pictures, unsolicited pictures of some sort.
Yes, so... we won't say any more about that.
So, well, if you're a fella, you might. You never know.
No. So, yeah, you can basically reach out to someone that of your liking. And I think they also have texting prompts on the app as well, like your favourite trip you've ever been on, like what's your music taste and your height and is smoking like a no for you. Like they have all these little prompts that you can tap and then message.
See, I don't know. I can't even get my Tesco online shop right now. Looking for a life partner online. It just sounds like too much.
She's waiting to see who delivers our groceries.
But you know what? I would love if anyone could text in or even on socials or WhatsApp. Let us know if you've met your partner on a dating app and also if it's been successful and long-distance relationships, if that's been successful as well. I'm very curious.
It's actually more unusual to meet someone, like a partner or a long-term love, outside of dating apps now because organically it doesn't happen too much anymore.
I always wanted an organic love, meet someone in the library or a cafe and you like just bump into them. You're like,
didn't happen.
Didn't happen for me, but anyway.
No. We watched too many rom-coms growing up.
Anyway, let us know how it worked for you and if it worked for you. Up next, we're over at the catwalk for some party wear that would be sure to knock your socks off. Stay tuned.
To celebrate the launch of the Virgin Mobile Cine Game in Odeon cinemas across Ireland, we've teamed up with Virgin Mobile to give away a Samsung Galaxy S22 every day for the next 7 days. The Virgin Mobile Cine Game is a game played on the big screen by the cinema audience as part of the pre-show. Once you download the Cine Game app, you use your mobile phone as the controller to race your friends and the rest of the cinema audience and collect those all-important Virgin Mobile SIM cards for points. For your chance to win one of these amazing Samsung Galaxy S22s, just answer this question. What type of operating system is used by Samsung? A, iOS or B, Android? To enter, call 1550-999-200 or text PRIZE to 57199. Best of luck.
If
very welcome back. It's that time of year where we get a bit glitzy and glam. And this morning we've got the inside scoop on all things party wear.
Yes, stylist Mandy Maher is here to show us how to keep it casual this party season. So what have you got for us, Mandy?
Well, I've lots going on this morning. So it is about the sparkle. It is the party season. But these are the first three looks we have this morning is all really about what you'd wear for going out, particularly this time of year now for the festive season.
Yeah, it's a bit blinktastic like yourself.
And blinktastic like myself. And all from Carrie Dunn this morning as well. So lovely, some beautiful pieces this morning. So we've Inga up first with us today, and I'm loving this because it's a really cool look. I think I'm loving the coat in particular. But we're starting off with the jewellery this morning, first of all. And we went with this beautiful, it's actually a set, but they're all sold individually as well. But we're starting off, of course, with these beautiful earrings because we wanted to pick up the colour in the earring, in the stone that's in the earring to match with the coat itself. But they're a beautiful gift idea as well. And, of course, lots of jewellery to choose from in Carrick Dunn. And we teamed it up then, as you can see here, obviously, with that beautiful chain.
I'm not sure if you can see it.
Well.
Ruby
red.
You can pick up the colour of the coat.
Isn't really it gorgeous, isn't it? Yes. And it's just very dainty. And it's a very feminine piece of jewellery as well. Mm-hmm. Because you didn't want to go over the top with jewellery, obviously, because of the outfit. We wanted to keep it a little bit more demure. So this coat, isn't it a fun fur coat?
Very snuggly. I do like it.
Yeah,
and it really
bounces
off the necklace. Now the coat stands out.
Just
so much more because of the jewellery.
Absolutely. And of course, we've been seeing a lot of these type of styling coats. We, of course, teamed it over the shoulder this morning. I think if you're going out at night time, it's always lovely to have a coat over the shoulder just to give it a little bit more of an edge and a little bit more elegant looking. Obviously, a coat like this you could certainly wear during the daytime if you wanted to as well and pop it with a polo neck and a pair of jeans. And that's what I love about something like this for this time of year.
And it's quite warm as well because we're getting into the plunging temperatures next week, so it's quite versatile that way. Now, when we come to the dress, I do spot a little surprise when it comes to the dress that we weren't expecting. My God, the sleeve in that is gorgeous.
Isn't it stunning, isn't it? I'm loving this dress. Now, some ladies are quite conscious of their arms, and that's what I love about a sleeve like this. It's three-quarter length. It is a sheer sleeve, but as you so said, Elaine, that faux fur, or the faux feather, I should say, I'm loving it detail. Isn't it fun, isn't it?
Pretty.
And it's really pretty, because some people are into the glitz and glamour and sequences. A dress like this is a lot more pared back, but it's a dress that won't date, which is also what I like. It's a piece that you'll definitely pull out time and time again as well. Mm. Now, as you see here, we added this belt this morning as well. It is separate. You didn't have to add it if you didn't want to, obviously, but I thought the belt just brought the whole thing together.
And
I
does like it have different, like, settings, like...
It absolutely does, yeah. So it will fit for... It's one size all.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it is in gold as well, so we went with the silver theme this morning on this.
Yeah, and, of course, we have the ring there that matches the set. We can see that picking up that little bit pop of colour as well.
It's beautiful, isn't it? And as I said, it's a lovely gift set. And indeed, as I said, you can buy them individually as well, but I'm loving this. And picking up the colours.
The details.
Subtle bling on that bag.
Yes, nice. I think, do you know what I like with a clutch bag? It's always nice to have a good clutch bag and a piece again like that. These are pieces I always feel you can sit back, you'll keep them in your wardrobe, you'll never get rid of them. So timeless pieces, but works well with an outfit like this.
And if you buy them now, they're quite sustainable because you have them forever.
Of course, absolutely. We welcome
keeping
our gorgeous
faux fur here as well.
Isn't it gorgeous? I'm loving this look. And that's what it's all about this morning. It's all about the festive season from Carrick Dunn. And so we're starting again with these great little earrings. Again, just very, very simple. It has the teal, as you can see, the colouring in the jewel there on that. Very, very simple, not overpowering. Some people like the big bling. We kept it quite demure again with the jewellery on this.
And you can see, once you have the sparkle, that it just picks it up quite nicely if you're having a lot of sheen and shine on the rest of the outfit as well.
Absolutely. Now, they do have a matching chain with that and accessories, but we didn't go with the chain this morning because of the V-neck. We just left it quite plain on the dress. But the coat here, as you said yourself, Elaine, this is the coat then in the black. Again, like that, a piece like this always works well. And there's always something about faux fur at Christmas time, isn't it?
I think everyone... I love it.
Yeah, kind of
don't really get away with it at any other time of the year, but you get away with it all at Christmas.
That's why.
You definitely do. And again, like that, pieces like this you'll always have. And do you know what I'd also mention about it as well? It's quite a light coat. So do you know the way sometimes with coats, it could just be overpowering or very heavy and just too warm, actually. But this particular coat really, really works well.
And layered up, I suppose, when you have the long sleeve dress underneath it, it does keep it warm if you need it. Because a lot of people still want to sit outside and they're not comfortable enough inside as well.
Absolutely.
When it comes to the aftermath for COVID.
This dress is nice on the arms as well.
It's lovely, it is a batwing type sleeve. And again, as we see, a beautiful drop here on the dress as well. Now, the dress itself, what we like about this, it's empire line. So for anyone that may be conscious of the tummy area, this is a great styling dress to go with.
It's quite stretchy, isn't it?
Yeah, it's actually a polyester fabric, actually. yeah, and it is. And there's a great stretch on it. Now, if you wanted to, you could add a belt. We didn't add a belt because, as you can see, it's quite a high waistline because the fact it's only just coming from the bust down from a drop. That's the reason we didn't add a belt with this morning. You see there, Pat was holding that gorgeous little silver clutch bag matching as well to give it all, bringing the whole look together and ready for the party season indeed.
Yeah, absolutely lovely. I have to say, I do like love a 4-4. I have a few of them now. And I think it'll be cold enough to bring them out next week. I can't wait.
I can't wait. You don't actually have more than any yet this year, so I'll be definitely bringing them out.
So fabulous.
Yeah, our gorgeous Mary Lee in this beautiful dress. And this is now bringing in a little bit more sparkle. Personally, I love sparkle, as you can obviously see when I'm wearing myself this morning. And that you all kindly slagged me off in the studio when I arrived in saying they'd all be seeing me. But anyway.
You did not slag me. You said you look lovely. You slagged yourself.
Thanks very much. So we're starting off with these gorgeous earrings. They're a diamond-shaped earring. I love these. I'm a massive fan of accessories, and I love these. And again, like that, they really bring the whole outfit together, I think, in the pearl, as you can see, a little diamond going on in those. But I love them. And not, again, not overpowering, but sets it all off, I think.
The dress is gorgeous.
The dress gorgeous?
I'm obsessed with the sleeves as well. Oh my God, it's stunning.
It's a stunning dress. Yeah. And as you can see here, it has a little tight cuff on the end of the sleeve. Lots of sparkle going on. It is V-neck. This would actually be a great dress for somebody that has large busted. You could easily, if you wanted to, add a chain. Personally, I didn't want to. I think it's nicer without.
I think when you have so much detail at the top of the sparkle of the sequin, you don't need anything too close to the neckline there.
Absolutely, that's for sure. I mean, then we just went off then and themed it up then, as you can see here, just with this gorgeous clutch bag. They have loads of accessories in Carrigdon at the moment, and in particular for this season, coming in for the party season, lots going on. But I'm loving this. It just really works well. And not like making a statement.
I'm going to go out there.
So do I. I think I'm going to head off after this forever. I never get a party with makeup after. Let me come off here.
Thanks for the excitement. Anyway, thanks a million, Madeleines.
Thank you.
Thank
you
both. In the next hour. Now, up next, she's a star on the rise. Dublin actor Niamh McCormack joins us after the break. You're very welcome back. Our next guest is just 21 years of age and she's already making a name for herself in the acting world with Netflix and Disney knocking on her door.
Well, she's soon set to star in an adaptation of The Magic Flute. Dublin native Niamh McCormack joins us. But first, let's take a look at her.
Where she gets it from. Niamh McCormack, thank you so much for joining us this morning. I have to admit, we know this girl since she was a child.
Yeah.
And I feel like an awful idiot. Her mother was on to me when she was on the panel. My daughter wants to be an actress. And I was like, oh, God, no. You better
finish her college course.
A proper degree first, because acting is very hard to make. Well, I feel like a right clown now. Look at you, touring the world.
It happened overnight.
Yeah. So tell us, first of all, that's The Magic Flute. Tell us about that, because that's quite a huge... It's your first major feature film role.
Yeah, first real movie ever. So it's basically the beloved Mozart's opera, and they're making it this adaptation, kind of modernising opera. And it's in a parallel world. We go into Mozart's beautiful opera through a secret passageway in the library. Wow. So it's quite like Harry Potter magical. I feel like everyone will really enjoy it.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah. We saw a gorgeous library there, which would be familiar to a number of people because the house that you were in features in The Sound of Music.
It does, yeah. We filmed in Schloss Leopoldskron, which you told me you were at last
year. I took my good wife there last year for our anniversary.
Yeah, in Salzburg, so where Mozart was born. Oh, it's
stunning. Oh, it's amazing. Yeah. Absolutely amazing.
So we filmed there in March.
If you're a fan of Mozart or a fan of The Sound of Music, you have to go there.
100%. It's in like the Austrian Alps, and it was the most stunning location I could ever be. It was like snowing every day. It was like a winter wonderland.
Yeah, so. Yeah. We just had
that didn't stop them partying until about 6 in the morning, though.
I'd say not. Now, we have to look at the corner over there with the studios. Once upon a time, you were modelling over there in the IrelandAM set. Now, how did you decide yourself to go from modelling to acting, and why did you decide that was the career path for you? Because it can be a tough slog and not everyone makes it.
Oh, definitely. And I think you need to know that going into this kind of job. Modelling was never what I wanted to end up doing. It's definitely great to get comfortable in front of the camera. I feel like now I'm not so scared. I think having a camera pointed at you can be quite... and like scary, you know? So modeling kind of brought me up to be more comfortable in my own skin. And then maybe around like 16, 17, I just didn't have the love for it anymore because I wanted that like expression, that extra level of expression and be able to kind of control the environment I was around. So acting, I was always doing acting, but I think then after I left school, it became a...
So no, she did take a college course.
Yeah. I did in acting in Bow Street.
Did you find it was a good way to kind of channel your emotions as well?
acting.
Yeah.
Oh my God, yeah, expressive. I think when I was younger as well, I felt a lot like an outsider, and then I found acting and it felt like I could express myself freely, yeah, creatively as well. Yeah. It's definitely freeing.
A lot of the stuff that we're going to see you in, the Magic Flute, I think, was included in that, was done during lockdown.
Yeah.
So what were those restrictions like?
Actually amazing in a weird way, because we had to spend so much time with the cast. So when we went away to film The Magic Flute, we were away for 5 weeks. In a normal scenario, maybe a week. You'd kind of fly in, do your bits, and then fly out. So we had to stay together for 5 weeks in this amazing Austrian castle. It's bloody great, do you know what I mean? We all got to bond and have this beautiful experience. And then you look back and you're like, oh my God, that was my lockdown. Filming this amazing movie in the Austrian Alps. So it was stunning.
But I remember, because I'm a big fan of sci-fi and fantasy, there I was watching The Witcher and you popped up in that. Like, The Witcher is a massive smash, of course, as well, all over streaming services. What was it like being on a set like that? Because you've got the likes of Henry Cavill, huge from Superman, of course, he was in The Tudors for years, worked in Ireland as well. I mean, that sort of elevated your career quite a lot, didn't it?
Yeah. So, a really funny story, I actually booked The Witcher and The Magic Flute in the exact same day. It was fucking amazing.
And by the way, and a big part in The Witcher as well.
Yeah, I play this legendary elven sorceress. I'm visited in some sort of a dream, and that was a surreal moment, I think, walking onto set in the whole costume, because the most amazing thing about acting is you can kind of transform into a different person. So I got these amazing ears and this amazing wig, and we were driven outside of London to this forest that had been like completely scorched. And it was surreal. And they handed me this baby. It's like a crying baby, his 5-week-old baby. It's like,
She was actually the babysitter. And then they eventually put her in the thing.
Yeah, she's actually fine, so we can have her in. But yeah, it was surreal. And I think I grew a lot as an actor from that one experience, holding that baby. I was like, just do it. Just look like you know what you're
doing. Never worked with babies or animals. Yeah. We had deer and parrots and everything on set yesterday, so we're halfway through with there. So what are you looking at now? What's in the pipeline for you?
Looking at now, so things are, you know, you have to be quite secretive of things you sign.
What are you allowed to tell us?
I can't really tell you a lot.
Have you done already?
I just finished filming a series for Netflix called The Effort Bucket.
It's called a rude name, but we're not
allowed to say it. We can't say it.
For a minute there, I thought we were going to have to jump in.
I know, I was like, an apology.
Yeah. Thanks, Niamh.
No worries. But by the same producers that produced The Crown, so Left Bank Productions, they're kind of branching out into more young adult screen kind of series. So it all takes place in London, and it follows this young girl called Mia who has just come out of an eating disorder clinic, and it's her kind of introduction back into society and her friends and how everyone reacts to it. So yeah, we were filming that up until October.
I don't know about you, but I'm jealous of you, because in that is one of my bucket list people that I want to meet. Stephen Fry. I am so jealous. What was it like working with that legend?
I didn't have any scenes with him, but...
Did you see him? Did you touch him?
I touched him. I smelt him. I was in the same room as him.
Wow.
He was just exactly as you'd think he'd be. He was just so warm and welcoming and of really beautiful energy and so intelligent and really generous with his time. Mm. So to have someone like that, I think, because we were all very young actors on that job, so to have someone there who was...
I've a 19-year-old now in our house, and he's big into series like Sex Education. So this is aimed at that demographic.
Totally, yeah. I think it's a recipe for success in a way. I think if you have stories that will reach young people, that people can relate to.
And talking about issues that are very important to them as well.
Yeah, a lot of like mental health stuff. I mean, definitely, I'm still, you know, a young adult, so we all go through this every day. It's not something that stops after you leave school. Mm. So sharing these stories and showing people that you're not alone, you can get through these things, is definitely...
Did you find because of your experiences, you can lend a bit more authenticity to the part?
Yeah, I think that you know what this person is feeling as an actor. You're kind of stepping back into your own past and reliving things. And I think that to be able to reach audiences and to be able to share people's stories, not even my own, but another character's story in a series, I hope would make people, you know, not feel so alienated or alone in what they're going through.
Do you ever get a bit scared or a bit like overwhelmed? Because it is quite, I've known you for a while and known you, until you've known her for a while as well, but it's kind of been a meteoric rise over the last few months with all the series you've been involved in. And this is only the start. I mean, we see you now, but you're going on to
great things. Do you get a bit daunted or afraid ever?
It's a weird thing with this industry because a lot goes on behind the scenes for a lot of months. So the Magic Flute I filmed like a year and a half ago, and then all these things, you're kind of filming them or attached to them for a long time before they come to any sort of fruition. So I think you're nearly mentally preparing yourself for releases of things. Definitely when something comes out, let's say on Netflix or in cinemas, it's quite daunting and scary, but I think you just have to remove yourself from it in a way and just live your normal life.
We're also going to see you very soon in Willow. That's as much as we can say about that. I'm going to get a slap.
Can we say any more about that?
But it's all. More than that. Yeah. But we are looking forward to seeing that.
Oh, yeah.
Remember, it's a series and it's not a film.
Yes.
Yeah. We can say that much.
OK, we can say. And that's as far as we can go. Between now and Christmas, though, are you now off? Are you...
Yeah, I'm helping my mum out with a charity ball that's happening next week, and you guys are invited if you'd like to come.
The
Lions Club, the ball.
And that's on in the Marker Hotel.
That's on in the Marker Hotel next Saturday.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm home for the next while, home from London. It's lovely to be home in Dublin
and
City.
And back down to earth helping your mum. Yes. Something's never changed.
Something's never changed, exactly.
And he's over there going, good girl, you mentioned that.
She thinks she's coming home for a break, and then mum starts
Mum starts soon giving me things to do, so it's great.
Yeah. Listen, absolutely lovely catching up with you once again, and I can't wait to see the Oscar.
Continued success.
Will you come on with us first when you win the Oscar? I really feel you should.
Right. I'll come here.
And a reminder, you can catch Niamh in the upcoming series of Willow from November 30th on Disney Plus.
Coming up after the break, get your berets at the ready. We're about to devour some French cookies in the kitchen. Stay with us. I've had a beret and ring of onions, string of onions around my neck.
We did some ballet as well. We're in French.
So we say bonjour. Anyway, that's about as French as we're going to get. They say no one does dessert like the French, and we're here to put that to the test.
Mm-hmm. Here to give us our Sunday morning certain ooh la la is Norma Kelly from Praline with her recipe for French madeleines.
Good morning.
Good to see you.
And you. So this morning I'm making French madeleines. So madeleines, I suppose, are very typical French little pastry. They're nice and buttery and light, and I know my kids love them. And we have them in the shop, and we sell like just with a little cup of tea or a cup of coffee. If you don't want anything, there are a couple of sweet bites, and just they're delicious, and I really love them.
Okay.
So I just thought they're really nice because for Christmas you can actually kind of make them a little bit fancy and it'll package them up, and they'd be nice little Christmas gift, I thought. Yeah, so it's a very simple recipe. So I have 4 eggs in here, and we'll start with making the mix, and my sugar, 200 grams of sugar, and we just whisk them together lightly.
Okay.
Just until they're nicely mixed, like that. And then I have my 200 grams of flour and a teaspoon and a half of baking powder. I've sieved those together already first. And I'm going to pop that in.
And it all goes in at once?
Yeah. Okay. It's very... Because you have the baking powder, that's your raising agent.
Yeah.
So that's quite handy.
It is. So you're not worried. Obviously, there's a lot of egg in it, so the egg is a raising agent, and also the baking powder is a raising agent. And so it's nice and easy to make. And then mix those together.
Now, if you're looking to make this, say, on a Sunday, or if you're looking for this to be your St. Stephen's Day or December 27th breakfast, it needs to be done the day before.
Yeah, so you have to make your mix the day before and rest in the fridge overnight before you bake it.
What does that do?
It just lets the flour, the gluten in flour, when you mix it like that, it toughens. So it makes sure that the mixture is nice and soft and that there'll be no... It won't have any,
So it won't be falling apart then.
Exactly. Yeah. So like that. So I'm adding 200 grams of butter. And if you have a look at the butter here, I've melted the butter in a pot, but I've left it like bubble a little bit. And this is what we call beurre noisette or nut brown butter. So it's a really nice smell.
Oh, you know, yeah. And it smells nutty.
Yeah, it smells delicious. Mm. Yeah. Now, if you don't have time to do that, that's fine. We're putting vanilla essence in as well, so you'll get some nice vanilla flavour off of it. Mm. But I like to make the butter like a nut brown butter, and you'll see all the little brown
residues. Is that a slow heat when you put the butter?
Yeah, about medium heat, and let it simmer away until the bottom goes brown.
And there's no like nutmeg or cinnamon in that. That's just from having.
That's just from the butter itself. Yeah. So the white part of the butter, it kind of caramelises.
Okay.
And it gives you a lovely flavour, and that's actually really nice as well if you were cooking a piece of white fish, to do a little bit of nut brown butter and put it over your white fish.
Oh no.
Getting all the tips.
It's all working. By the way, today.
And of course, the French do love butter as well, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I was just saying, today is Steer Sunday, which I only found out about the other day when I was.
What is that?
Yeah, you see.
And I never heard that
My wife was the same. She said, what? we're making puddings the other day.
Oh, yeah.
And I was trying to find out what's the best way to steam it, because I don't want to boil it, I want to steam it. And it says, yeah, apparently this Sunday, the fifth Sunday out from Christmas, is Steer Sunday when you make the pudding mix. Most people, I think, would have it done by now. And when you're stirring, you have to go clockwise. You have to go clockwise from east to west, because that's the journey the three wise men made. So there you go.
And is that when you put in your wishes?
That's
when
you put in your wishes.
Today's the day when a lot of people will be doing that.
Now, I put a little bit of vanilla extract in there. You could put in lemon zest or orange zest or any other flavours. Or like you could put cinnamon or a spice in there as well for Christmas time if you liked. Now, so that's the mix. So I would put that in a tub, cover it, and put it in the fridge overnight to rest normally. Okay.
So we're going to pretend we did this yesterday. Okay. Get into the TARDIS and go.
And then I have, this is a traditional Madeleine mould.
Oh, and easy to get?
Yeah, you can get them. Sometimes you'd see them in the supermarket, you know, the special buys in Lidl and Aldi, they might have them. Mm. But if you had any other small little mould or a little cake tin, you can still use this mix as well, or even like mini cupcakes.
Yeah.
This would work in those as well.
Okay.
So the Madeleine mould is that shell shape and this little bump on top.
Okay.
Right. Or the bottom shell, should I say. Sorry, that's the top, that's the bottom. The little bump on top is kind of indicative of a good Madeleine. And then...
It's like a mini cupcake on the top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'm going to... scoop that in there. A couple of little scoops like that. So I've got like a little mini ice cream scoop. Or you could just use 2 teaspoons or a piping bag if you wanted as well. Okay, so I'm going to pop in a few.
Do you fill it or do you let the
I fill it nearly to the top. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
So I'm going to do maybe 4 and pop those in.
And then can you play around when you have a jar and you want the toppings? Like, does it have to be chocolate? Can you put, like, strawberries?
No.
Yeah.
Anything you want. Like, we sell them just naturally like that.
Yeah.
Or you could pop them in a bag just like that as well. And they'd be lovely. With a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
And they're very
popular. I'm starving.
Yeah.
I wasn't until we started doing this, but now I am.
It's the food every time that gets me. That's why I don't have breakfast.
This time of year as well, we've got having parties and stuff.
Yeah.
So they'd be lovely.
A little bit of minis.
Easy to pick up at a party.
Okay,
And eat, because you don't want anything messy.
So that goes into the oven for how long?
That goes into the oven for about 10 minutes.
What
180 degrees.
10 minutes, 180 degrees. All right, and this is the goodness that comes out.
This is, these come out, the ones I prepared earlier here. And again, that's naturally the way they would be, and eat them like that, and they're delicious. I'm putting some chocolate on them because, like I said, we could make some some sprinkles. And these are little freeze-dried raspberries, which you get them in a lot of supermarkets actually. Yeah,
they'll stick to the chocolate.
Yeah, and they're nice in your porridge and stuff, So the chocolate is melted here. Mm-hmm. I'm using good quality dark chocolate, 55%. Mm-hmm. When you're melting your chocolate, if you're using a bar, we get ours in little buttons.
Yeah.
If you get a bar, chop it up small. Put it over, like, you can see I've got hot water here, but it's not even boiling. Just keep it hot and just very gentle simmer.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
A glass bowl or a stainless steel bowl, pop the chocolate in, put it over. And when you're melting it, half melt it. Leave some lumps in it. Never stand away from it. Always keep stirring it.
Yeah.
If your chocolate gets too hot in one part, it gets...
Oh, it burns fast.
It burns very fast. So I have
that
done.
So will we pop one in? Will we coat it in the chocolate or just have it? What do you recommend?
I'm going to half coat them.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
Do you like to do that?
We should try one.
I think you should.
Yeah.
Do you want to bring it over there too? No.
Okay.
We are running out of time, so...
Oh, yeah. We'll try one very quickly. I got some chocolate. We'll both dip them into the chocolate.
There we go. So if you want to just
pop one in.
Yeah. So you pop yours in.
Pop them in like that. Give it a little shake.
Okay.
Pop it on. And then I've got some Christmas sprinkles and I've got some of the freeze-dried raspberries.
All right.
I'll do some raspberries on this.
I'm afraid to lean mine down in case I lose some of my chocolate.
All right. Here, I'm going to do the taste test.
You're going to do the taste test now?
Mm.
Well, she's a happy girl. Mm-hmm. And I'll be a happy boy in a minute. Norma, thank you so much. Full recipe details, by the way, are already up on our website. You can find out more from Norma at her website, praline.ie. Or, of course, you can stop into the Praline Cafe in Mitchelstown, County Cork. Tell them we sent you, and then actually they might pay our bill from the last time
we were there. I'm still eating, so you do mine as well.
Still to come, music legends UB40 will be chatting to us, so we'll take a quick break and we'll see you back here very soon.
Now let's check on your morning paper, starting with the Sunday Independent. The headline there reads €476 million for housing still unspent as crisis grows. The paper reports that nearly €500 million of the government's housing budget for the first 9 months of the year was not spent, according to a secret memorandum given to ministers last week.
The Business Post opens with Ryan Industry will have to pay for climate change damage. It says that Eamon Ryan's new statement claims that businesses in highly polluting sectors such as fossil fuels and aviation should face new levies to pay for the global damage done by climate change.
On to the tabloids now. The Irish Mail on Sunday opens with the headline, Cabinet Fears Over Russian Poll Meddling. The paper reports that ministers and government officials are employing increased security measures due to deepening fears of Russian infiltration.
Sunday World opens on the headline, Road to Hell. It writes about the story of Dale Fogarty. He robbed a car. There was a teenage girl sitting in the back seat. Fogarty was killed in a head-on crash, leaving the girl seriously injured.
And finally, the Mirror leads with caught offside. The paper states that a football fan who sparked an airport security alert after climbing over security screening missed his flight to the Qatar World Cup and has been ordered to pay more than €1,000 to charity.
OK. And it all begins today.
It all begins today. Were you going to be watching it?
Do you know what? I don't know. And I remember when the last World Cup was in Russia and I thought, it shouldn't be in Russia.
Yeah.
There's something not right here. And then when I heard Qatar was getting... Well, it was all announced around the same time at the start of the last decade. I thought, no. But then as a football fan, you know, you start...
It's the World Cup.
And then it's the World Cup. It only happens every 4 years. And... within a couple of days of the World Cup starting, Portugal played Spain. The game ended in a 3-3 draw. And, you know, did you see the Portugal-Spain?
Yeah.
No, I didn't.
The FOMO will kill you.
You have to watch the highlights.
Yeah.
So I started watching the highlights. From a footballing point of view, the last World Cup actually got better as it reached the knockout stages. This year, I'm really torn. Really, like today's game.
Like, it'll be Ronaldo's captaining Portugal. I mean, that'll be one to watch with his recent antics.
Yeah, well, when he gets out, he's getting his own UB40, isn't he?
By the looks of things. Would you watch it? Would you have any interest?
Normally, I never watch football. It's only if my dad's watching Arsenal and
you
I'm forced to watch.
Arsenal,
I did,
you?
And I'll watch Arsenal for him and that's about it. But yeah, just with everything going on, I'm not sure with like the ethics around it and all the people like building the stadium. But like you said, Martin, it's the highlights. People are still going to be so interested naturally. So I'm sure I'll see it all over social media.
Yeah, you can't really get escape from it with the best will in the world. You won't be able to, but they'll tell you there'll be a lot of more beverages in the pubs here than there will be in Qatar.
Just was it Friday?
2 days. Everyone had arrived, and they're sorry, lads, no pints for you unless you pay 20
grand. How convenient!
I don't know about you, but like at this time of year, I'm prone to all sorts of, like, I got COVID last month, then I got a chest infection on top of it, a sinus infection. I'm floored. So when you're sick and you're feeling a bit iffy, you just want to be sitting on the couch in your hoodie, your blankie, and just put on some comfort music, movies. So, like...
So, what's the comfort movie?
Well, what's your comfort?
There's been a new survey of 2,000 millennial parents with kids between 4 and 12. And while the parents prefer to watch rom-coms, so they stick on the Bridget Joneses and those sort of ones, and the kids prefer the Harry Potter series. Now, I do have to admit...
I prefer Harry Potter.
Seven movies there, lads.
Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings, do the whole marathon. I watched the whole series, yeah. That's what I do. But, like, what would you watch if you're sick? What's your comfort go-to movie?
If I'm sick, I always watch a musical on Disney.
Like, what one?
So I love Encanto. I love In the Heights. I love Princess and the Frog. I just, yeah, they just make me feel like I'm healing my inner child when I'm sick and on the couch.
You sing along to them. Do you sing along to your movies? You probably watch Rocky.
No, actually, believe it or not, if I'm not feeling 100%, I will watch these movies again and again and again. Something's Got to Give, Jack Nicholson.
Jack Nicholson? He's very funny in that. What's that other one he's in? As Good As It Gets, no.
As Good As It Gets. Mm-hmm. Great film. Yeah. And again, I would never get tired watching that film.
Because I think with films like that, they're so cleverly scripted, you find a new joke every time you're reading.
Yeah, you see stuff that you haven't seen before. Yeah, yeah. No, the movies like that, I'll always throw an eye towards that. And no matter when, I'll text my brother, As Good As It Gets is on again. Channel, blah, blah, blah.
A group watch.
And it's a group watch. Yeah. But do you know what? Whether you're sick or not, it's a great movie.
Oh, lovely. Well, anyway, I'll stick to me Harry Potter. I don't know about you. But up next, one of the most successful bands of all time, UB40, joins us for a chat. Stay with us.
Okay. But before all of that, fancy bagging yourself a new car? Well, you're in luck. As all this week, we've teamed up with Toyota Ireland to give you the chance to win the Toyota Aygo Cross.
Here's all you need to know.
We've teamed up with Toyota Ireland to give you the chance to turn heads like a celebrity in the Toyota Aygo Cross, the compact crossover built for everyday life. For your chance to win, just call or text the numbers on screen and answer the question.
Back. I've been singing their songs all morning.
Yes, you have. It's been quite annoying.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, but they're good. Listen, we're going to talk to three of the members of the most successful British group of all time. With a career spanning five decades, they've achieved multiple number one hits, sold over 100 million records, and were Grammy nominated four times during their career.
Yeah, there's been rats in the kitchens and there's been red, red wine being sung all over the place this morning. And I'm blaming you guys, the legendary UB40, join us on the line now. But first, let's hear some examples of their chart-topping hits.
Please welcome the brilliant Robin, Jimmy and Earl, the founding members of the iconic reggae band UB40. Good to see you, lads.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I tell you, a fair play to you for being up this early on a Sunday, Robin. You said this is nearer your bedtime.
It's just past my bedtime.
We're listening to some great songs there. And look, your version of Elvis Presley's Can't Help Falling in Love. Better remembered than the movie was, lads. It wasn't such a great film, but a great, great version of the song.
I remember Sharon Stone saying exactly that, the song was more successful than the film.
That's gas. Yeah. Listen, we need to talk because you, like we said in the intro, you've done so much. The number ones, the 100 million sales, Grammy Award nominations, awards coming out of the yin yang, shall we say. But for each of you, like Errol, starting with you, what's the most memorable moment of the last 45 years?
Oh, well, it's been a lot, you know. I think the Ivor Novello Award, when you're talking about awards, I think that's the most prestigious award that we probably we've been given so far. So I was very pleased when we got that, you know, for songwriting, obviously. So that was a good day. That was many years ago now, though.
Yeah, yeah. So another one's due, is what Errol is saying. Jimmy, for you?
Definitely, yeah.
And for you, Robin?
I don't know about awards because they don't mean anything like as much as. The fans do to me. So I would say probably playing South Africa after Mandela was out of prison and became president and apartheid was outlawed. We'd been observing the cultural boycott for 20 years. So when all that went away and we were invited to go and play South Africa and we played to 70,000 people a night and had them singing our songs back to us, songs that have been banned by the government, that was a real goosebump moment, and I think was probably, yeah, one of the greatest days of my life, I think.
Yeah, I mean, when you look back at the momentous times in history over the last four decades, I mean, so many, you've lived and played through them all. But we have to mention, of course, that your lead singer, Duncan, he retired earlier this year, and sadly, you lost Brian after a three-year battle with cancer. So what is it like kind of staying together and continuing on with the band, with essentially two of your founding members gone?
I think so. Go on, I'll go in there. I think certainly when it comes to Brian, because he was such a prolific songwriter and such a big part of the band, that's a hole we're never going to fill. You know, he was a very important member of the band, you know, and we do miss him live and on the records. You know, his input was really important. But, you know, we're the guardians of the heritage, and it's his heritage as much as ours. And we love doing what we do, you know, and we've got good players there to play his riffs. And, you know, we're just as much UB40 now as we always were, really.
Mm. Oh, no, it's a great legacy to carry on in his memory. But yeah, like I said, he is missed, and that saxophone playing of his was a trademark of UB40's set. You've got Matt Doyle in as lead singer. He stepped in when Duncan stepped out. And Robin, he's a good fit for the band.
Absolutely. We worked with him on the last album, which was a collaboration album, when he was singing with the band Kyoko. We worked with him then, and I remember then working in the studio with him thinking, this guy's a real good singer, you know, and he'd be a great fit with the band. And then, unbelievably, Duncan suffered his stroke and had to retire. And I didn't even think about it. I just went to the rest of the guys and said, Matt Doyle's the man. They all agreed, and we went and offered him the job, you know. He's been a fan since he was 2 or 3 years old. He'll tell you stories about how he remembers singing our songs on the back seat of his mum and dad's car, you know, as a kid. And he's grown up with the songs. So it's lovely to have someone. It always is lovely to have someone with renewed vigour and enthusiasm in the band, you know. And someone, you know, as young as I feel, it's great to have somebody in the band like that.
As young as you feel, that's absolutely gas. But you've done some amazing things. Like UB45, your album has been released recently enough, and the main single off that was actually used as the anthem for the Commonwealth Games, which of course was in Birmingham this year. It's pretty amazing, I'd say, to have that accolade, is it, Robin?
Absolutely, yeah. The album's not released until next year because we're still working on it. But yeah, that was a track that we did for the album, and we wrote it with the Commonwealth Games in mind, and they loved it so much they made it the official anthem, which was fantastic. We got to hear it played at all the events, and it was great fun.
Yeah, and it was back in your hometown as well, which was also cool. Earl, to finish off the Commonwealth Games, you did a rendition of Red, Red Wine. And it's not... And some people are aware of this, not all people, though, that you didn't know that was a Neil Diamond song.
No, yeah. We had no idea. We knew it as a song by Tony Tribe.
Yeah, so, like, obviously, when we was growing up, it was a big hit in the reggae charts, you know, before we even got a band together, you know, when we was like 11 years old or whatever. And yeah, it wasn't until we actually recorded it, like Robin says, we found out it was Neil Diamond and
N Diamond was on the song credit, and you thought that was it Negus Diamond?
That was a joke that we cracked in 1983, and it's still doing the rounds.
But he actually says your version of the song is his favourite version of the song. So
well, he has to say that. He has to say that. It went number one in 24 countries.
Absolutely no choice. So, but that song is played in every disco, every wedding, every gathering around the world since the minute it was released, and it's still being played now. And I have to say, Jimmy, I suppose you're celebrating a certain vintage today. Would you ever get sick of listening to it or hearing it?
No, of course we don't. We love playing it every time. He lied. we want to play new material all the time. That's what we really want to do. So when people go, oh, can you play this? Can you play that? And, we go, oh, can we just play some new stuff?
Yeah. but it's kind of amazing though when your band formed. I mean, there were no bands in Britain really doing your kind of music, your reggae, your kind of fusion of what you did. So you kind of started a new trend in some ways. A lot of artists tried to emulate what you were doing. Didn't work, mind you, but they tried, Jimmy.
Well, I think we showed the way. I think we were quite innovative at the time, you know, when it came to a mixed band, you know, and choosing to do reggae. But that's all circumstantial because we come from Birmingham, where there's loads of people from Jamaica live there, you know, and it wasn't sort of worked out in our heads, you know. We just did what came naturally to us as a bunch of friends from that inner city area of Birmingham. You know, Birmingham informs everything we do. That's why we were very proud to represent our city at the Commonwealth Games, you know, because we love Birmingham.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
You know,
No, a great honour. Earl, with a new album on the way, there has to be a tour, and you're venturing out on one. UB45 is what you're calling it, to celebrate 45 years together as a band.
Yeah, you know, that's what we do. That's what we... obviously, after the pandemic, we was, you know, chomping at the bit to get out on the road. We recently just came back from America. We've done a six-week tour of America, which is like our first proper... you know, body of work since after the pandemic. So yeah, we're raring to go. Again, we've had a little bit of time off, we've been recording, but is obviously what we're all about, you know. We always have great gigs. Obviously the new lead singer Matt Doyle is fitted in really well. We call him Matt Hollywood Doyle now because he wants to go online and have a look. So we're all happy and you know. Get on the road. Tuck it to him, baby.
Yeah, on the road.
Yeah. And I have to say, we do have to wish you a big happy birthday now, Jimmy, because Martin was going to sing, but I've convinced him not to. His vocal cords are a bit worn out from all the songs he's been singing in my ear all morning. You'll be lucky. But happy birthday. I hope you're going to have a lovely celebration.
Oh, yeah. I'm Robin the Stevie fan.
I'm 22 for the third time.
It's the... He's celebrating his 22nd birthday for the third time, for those who might have missed it. The presents will arrive to the house from all the rest of the guys in the band fairly soon, Jimmy.
and how they are amused by that one. Listen, lads, it's been absolutely lovely chatting to this morning. Best of luck with the tour and, of course, the album. And sure, we'll see you when you get to Dublin,
congratulations
hopefully.
Congratulations on 45 years. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Come say hi when we get there.
We'll do. We'll hold you to that one. But he's still not allowed to sing. Right, to get your hands on tickets to UB40's upcoming shows in Castlebar and Belfast next month, head over to ticketmaster.ie.
Up next, more party wear on the catwalk. Stay with us. We're back after this break.
Welcome back. If you're looking to spruce up your party wear wardrobe, we've got the latest in what's hot this Christmas season. Speaking of, stylist Mandy Maher is back to show us how to get the most out of our party styles. Good morning once again.
Good morning, Elaine.
Now, you're very blingy today. We're keeping with the Christmas theme.
We are indeed. And I have to say, because I've been getting lots of messages, my own outfit today is also from Carrigdon as well. So it's getting into the party season for sure. But what we're going to have a look at now is three looks that are kind of getting you into the festive mood for over the Christmas period. Yeah. So whether it's Christmas Day, Stephen's Day, or if you're indeed visiting family or friends. And that's the look that we actually are going to show
Which
you now.
We're keeping with the bling.
So, yeah, we are. You know, we all love a bit of sparkle. I know, it's kind of hard to get away from it. But we're starting off, first of all, with these great drop earrings. Again, very much a statement piece. Aren't they fab?
Wow.
Yeah, I'm loving these as well. I'm loving the three different drops on them, the fact that they're all different, and yet, like that, they're dressy at the same time. But I think these are just fab. And they're quite light as well.
Heavy either, I was going to say that. Because sometimes they just drag the ear off you at the end
and nothing
of the night.
Is
like,
bad.
Never again.
And your ears are stinging then for hours later as well.
Your shoes are sore as well. It's just never good. So anyway, that looks like a good one.
And then, of course, it's this jumper. I think this is a real Christmas Day jumper, obviously, with the colour being that kind of a maroon style colour. It's beautiful, loving it, and a little bit of sparkle of going on with it as well. But it's quite nice, isn't it?
That's lovely, and you could wear that so much over the Christmas period as well. And with a skirt, you can dress it up, dress it down. Very versatile piece altogether.
Exactly. It sure is, and I'm like, and again, like that, just it's kind of like that mohairy kind of a look, but of a wool, but just to let you know it's not itchy. Because I think that's always important when people see knitwear like that, they often get frightened or think it would be needed something underneath it. You definitely don't.
And you don't want to wear it all the time if you're wearing a dress for a sequence.
Yeah.
I mean, you want to have the bling, but something a bit more comfortable, and that actually works. And you know, I'd love the skinny jeans as well, work really well.
Aren't they great? And I'm loving these jeans. There's a great stretch in these jeans, just for people to note, and as well as that they're that bit high-waisted as well, because for me, I don't understand, I cannot do low-waist.
No.
I just can't.
Why are they back in fashion?
I don't know, because they're just the most uncomfortable pair of trousers ever, or jeans. So these are a great stretch, they're high-waisted, and as I said, very, very comfortable. We teamed up then with this bag just to match the whole look. The bag, as you see, is on one shoulder, but you can obviously wear it as a crossbody if you wish. But again, like that, not too big, fits what you need to pop into it, and off
it fits a load in there.
It's an everyday bag,
a pair of fit flops in there as well, if you wanted to.
That's very smart.
A comfy place for walking home or place of ballet. Yeah. See, up there's
so
the thing.
It's a nice look, very casual look, but it's nice for Christmas Day, I think. It's just getting into the spirit of it all.
Lovely. So what do we have next?
So next up we've got Pat, and this is one of my favourite looks this morning from Carrick Dunn, I just think. And only this woman can rock this look, if I do say. She's loving it and oozing it all, and so right. And starting off with this fabulous fedora. We all know fedoras have this thing. I think there's always something around the Christmas period as well with a fedora, but I just think it oozes class.
They come in different sizes now.
They come in. It actually does come in different sizes, but it also comes in a few colours as well. But I'm loving, of course, this beige colour, and it's just really racy. Actually, I think if you're going to the races over the Christmas period,
even
I
think it's day off,
nice. I don't know if I can pull it off, but she wears it so well.
It's stunning. Then we've got this fabulous coat. I love this. I love the colour. I love the shade. It's in a few colours. It's from extra small to XXL as well. To note on that, you see the drawstring and there on the waistline to clinch in the waist.
To have a drawstring waistline.
Yeah, and it's nice, isn't it? Of course, then we've got the four button, the double breasted, but again, large pockets at the front. Very, very classy. And if you note on the sleeve, it is actually pinned up with a little button on the sleeve, which can easily, if you wish, Pat has shown us here, is you can actually wear it a long sleeve as well if you want to. Yeah. So is that, but I like it rolled up. I think it's a little bit more dressier rolled up, but it's obviously your own preference. But it's a beautiful coat, loving the lapel on it as well.
And the top underneath is full of gorgeous tones.
Isn't it fabulous? And very autumnal colours, really, I suppose. You've got the greens, the mustards. Love this again. And again, it's very, very easy to wear with, if you want to. Actually, I think it'd be fabulous with a black leather skirt too, if you wanted to.
Yes.
It could be quite nice around the Christmas period.
Of course, those tones as well are picked up in the jeans.
They are indeed, and the jeans fab. I'm loving it. They're a crop style jean. They have the little turn up at the end, little frill as we can see there on the pockets. I just think I love this. I love the full look. I just think it's really classy, chic. You're dressed up for the day, whether you're going meeting the girls, meeting family. I think this
and
is.
And did you turn up those yourself?
No, they actually come like
they
this.
They actually come like this. So that's sometimes easier because they're a bit more precise, because roll down jewelry's lovely. I'm picking up the bit of bling.
And of course then got two beautiful bracelets and sold separately, but again, like that, as I said, Carrick Dunn, lots of accessories going on with what they have in store, but just to finish the whole look.
And then we are looking at that lovely bag.
Another gorgeous bag.
The bag, of course, in the beige. As we can see, it's a little bit padded with the chain detail as well. And again, you can easily wear this crossbody, or indeed, if you wanted to put the strap away and just have it as a clutch.
Yeah.
It's almost like a Kate Spade bag, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very designer inspired, all right. But I'm loving it. I love this full look. I just think it's beautiful.
Oh, and you know what? Not everyone can pull a hat off of my dog, Pat Kennedy.
She sure can.
This is my kind of look now. Yeah. Very cozy coat.
I could see you in this.
Yeah, isn't it gorgeous? And there's definitely something about a camel coat, which I think is a definite wardrobe staple. But again, starting with these great little drop earrings, again, quite simple between the two colours of the gold and green, but I like these. They're nice and, again, quite light on the ears.
And so when we look at what we have as well, going down to the coat, of course, that colour, it's just one button, is it, or is it the double?
It's one button, but it's an oversized coat. I just wanted to note that as well. Oversizing, ladies, has been really, really big this season, and it is going to be absolutely huge.
So when you're getting oversized, should you go just your normal size, and that's the way it's supposed to look?
Go your normal size.
Sometimes I go one size up.
Yeah.
Because I love that oversized look.
And it is, but it's really, you'd need to try on probably for oversized, because what you want to careful not to add too much bulk either. Yeah. It looks way too big on you. Yeah. I would personally probably stay with your actual normal clothing size. We teamed up with this great scarf, again, a designer-inspired scarf. Yeah. And again, just to add that little bit, probably to give it a little bit more warmth. Camel coat for me is a must and a wardrobe staple. Absolutely.
The dress is beautiful, Lucy, peeping through there, that lovely winter kind of forest green.
Isn't it gorgeous, yeah. Elaine? And you see then a little bit of sparkle going on. Again, I think a dress like this would be fabulous for Christmas Day too. It's beautiful. It has a belt detail. If you wanted to, you could easily remove the belt and put another belt with it. If you wanted to dress it up a little bit more, you could easily. I left
V-neck is very flattering as well.
Yeah. Isn't it?
And the sleeves also,
And that sheer sleeve going on. Again, a very comfortable dress. You could wear it with knee-high boots. We went with a little ankle boot today. But again, I just think it's a nice, fun, beautiful dress.
And picking up the detail and the gold detail again in the crossbody bag. That's gorgeous.
So it's nice. It brings the whole look together, doesn't it? I'm loving it. And again, a nice colour. But again, bang on trend. All from Carrick Dunn. They have 42 stores nationwide, or indeed you can buy online. So lots
Thank
going on.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Mandy.
You both. Thanks for having me here this morning. Thank you.
Now, up next, new generation Scream Queen Jenna Ortega is back. And this time she's taking on the Munsters. We're talking telly. That's next.
The watch is to last 2 weeks. We are proposing 8-hour shifts.
There is to be no conferring between the two of you.
On the 14th day, you will each present your separate testimony.
May I ask, gentlemen, no one has told me what precisely is wrong with the girl.
Anna O'Donnell doesn't eat.
How long exactly has it been since the last time the girl ate?
4 months.
That's impossible. Thumbs up. And eyes wide open. Are you nervous at all?
Why should I be nervous? I don't eat sweets. I live in manna. From heaven.
And how does that feel?
Full.
Anna is in danger.
She's an actress.
She's chosen.
Yes, welcome back. We're looking at next week's television highlights now with our resident expert, Killian O'Sullivan. They actually called you Mr. Killian O'Sullivan.
I thought
I'd have to actually genuflect.
Yeah. Well, yes, and this week, of course, marking the death of Vicky Phelan, there is no better place to start than with the new documentary commemorating her life and the legacy she left behind for women in Ireland. Killian, what can you tell us about Vicky Phelan in her own words?
So this documentary has been put together by Virgin Media. It's a 60-minute documentary, and this is so Vicky's story. I'm sure over the last week or so, people are wise to exactly what unfolded over the course of the last number of years in Vicky's life, and how she took what was just such a horrific incident and turned it around to be this positive voice to shine a light on these 221 plus women who found themselves in a similar situation to herself. The fact that she refused to sign the NDA so that she could stand up and speak, and she wouldn't just go quietly into the night. It was just, she's a hero, an absolute hero.
One word that always comes into my head is bravery.
Oh, it really is. So there's been a lot of opportunities where she has sat down with people, with the likes of Virgin Media, and spoken, and for different reasons you have to cut interviews short or whatever. So this, they can dip back into those interviews now and kind of give us the extent cut for a lot of them, and then also draw in close friends and family and stuff to talk about Vicky's life and the legacy now that she's left behind.
Well, she's an absolute hero.
Yeah.
Complete and utter hero who did what she did for the sake of her daughter and everybody else's daughter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Really is. And just it's one of those things that this will be, if you're somewhat familiar because you can't have missed it on social media over the last couple of weeks, this is an opportunity to sit down and really
get to know her
and get to know the full story and know why people who did know her and people who do know her story are in so much admiration of her.
Yeah, I know. And look, great story, and look, great sense of humour the lady had. We had her. I've interviewed her a number of times, and there was always a bit of fun in Vicky as well. That's on tonight.
That's tonight, Virgin Media One. Yeah, so that's one. If you can record that, if you're not around, record it.
And Vicky, watching that
straight after I'm a Celeb. So just leave the telly where it is.
Yeah,
you'll get to enjoy that. All right, next Wednesday, which is landing on Wednesday.
Yeah, very convenient, right? So this is the next spin from the Addams Family. So, of course, the Addams Family have been knocking around like absolutely donkeys of years. And this is a really interesting take because they're going into the kind of bit of an origin story, backstory of Wednesday Addams, and it's a coming of age, and it's really nicely done. Tim Burton himself, by the way, who was originally meant to be doing the Addams Family movie in the 90s, had to back out to do Batman. He finally gets a chance to step up, and he directs the first four episodes of this series. He's also executive producer on the whole series, so he's got his dark ways about him that he brings to the show. And you can see from the trailer, it starts off Wednesday as your average 15-year-old girl, and she's in high school, and she finds herself getting into trouble quite a lot because she sees the world very differently. And you can see that all of the high schools up to that point, even stylistically, they're pops of colour and high contrast versus she's almost lives in black and white.
Yeah.
So then they eventually bring her to a school that would be more suited to her and her type of people. It's quite gothic, it's quite dark, but it is brilliant. And James, the producer on the show, is a huge fan of this, loves this. He's very luckily has got a sneak peek of the whole series and he's binging it.
And speaking of like the spookiness and the darkness of it all, how come it wasn't released at Halloween and now in November? Well, is there a market for that spookiness in November?
I've been trying to look into why. The only thing I can assume is that they had enough. Netflix had their big Halloween releases. And this, although the Addams Family are synonymous with Halloween, we dressed up as the Addams Family ourselves this year, they are quite synonymous with it. It is a story that lives beyond Halloween. So I think maybe they chose to do it on the lead up to Christmas so that they weren't just bound to it being a Halloween series, that they could make it something a bit more evergreen.
Yeah. Okay, and Christina Ricci is in it. And
she features.
She was Wednesday.
She was the original Wednesday,
back in the 90s, that Tim Burton never got to do. So he gets to work with her now. Let's move on. That's dropping on Netflix on Wednesday.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Guardians of the Galaxy have a Christmas special.
Yes. So James Gunn, who's kind of behind the Guardians of the Galaxy series, he has always loved the idea of doing Christmas specials. I don't know if you remember, Star Wars did a Christmas special many moons ago, and it was
best forgotten.
It did not go well. But he loved the idea of doing that, of taking these, you know, people that you'd only ever see in the cinema on a movie, and then bringing it to something a little bit more, you know, focused just around the holiday season. So this is the first time Marvel are doing this, very much testing the waters. Disney are in a position to be able to test the waters, and you know, it's not going to cost them too much money, but they've got all the cast back. There's no subs here. All the A-team are there for this. And loosely based around the main character, he's feeling a bit blue, and his band of merry men go to Earth to try and find a way of cheering him for Christmas. And they end up tracking down Kevin Bacon, who plays himself in this movie, because they think he loves Footloose, obviously. And they try and kidnap Kevin Bacon to bring him to Chris Pratt's character as a Christmas gift. And the hilarity ensues from that. I hope that this is something we see more of. I hope that all of the different Marvel IP end up over the years getting these Christmas specials. Because for me, watching series like The Office or you know, The Simpsons or any of the series, when they do a Christmas special, I loved them. So I love the idea of making Christmas specials a thing again.
Okay, and we like it too. And enjoy this, because when Guardians of the Galaxy 3 comes around, it mightn't be an easy watch.
Yeah, James Gunn has said he has no problem finishing characters entirely, shall we say, and we can expect to see some of that in the new Guardians of the Galaxy. So this might be one of your last chances to enjoy some of the characters on screen.
Also, people get so attached with Marvel, like you really get attached with the characters. That's why I'm glad I'm not superly into.
Okay. You know? I think he was just watching a couple of episodes of Emmerdale and he thought, oh, that's how you do it. Right, let's move on to Echo 3.
This one sounds exciting. I was asking you about this one.
This is a series for Apple. Apple aren't as prolific.
We're not speaking.
I'm going to the top of the class now.
Apple aren't making as many series as some of the other streamers. We'll just keep it simple. But when they do release a series, it's generally really good, like Severance and The Morning Show. And when they do decide to invest in a series, it's usually really, really good. Unlike Netflix, they churn a lot out and some aren't great and some are good, like Wednesday, but some other ones they miss a little bit. Whereas Apple have shown that most of the time when they're releasing these series, they're rock solid.
It's quality.
The people behind this, I tell you what, you've got.
And what's the synopsis?
So basically, this scientist is on the Venezuelan border, gets kidnapped and is held captive for ransom. And Luke Evans plays her brother, and Luke Evans and this scientist's husband have some tactical training with special forces, and they end up taking upon themselves to try and get her back.
Okay, and that's on Apple TV.
Apple TV.
From now?
From Wednesday. It's when the first
Wednesday.
Episode.
Lots first of things on Wednesday. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, earlier we added a certain je ne sais quoi. The War Breakfast. I don't know how I did that. Anyway, here's how you can copy us at home.
Whisk the eggs and sugar together. Sift the flour and baking powder together and mix into the eggs and sugar. Mix in the melted butter and vanilla. Allow to rest in the fridge overnight. Spoon into Madeleine molds and bake for 10 to 12 minutes.
I tell the truth, how many did you have?
I had two.
Go on.
I had one but with chocolates. I'm very nice.
I didn't have chocolate on mine.
Two.
Thank you for outing me very much. Now, coming up on tomorrow's show, Dr. Evie Nisulawan will chat tackling Ireland's climate pledges.
It's the last week of I'm a Celebrity, so we look ahead to...
The last week? Already?
Yeah, well, it's a Monday week it finishes, but soon enough, we're rolling towards it. We're going to have a look to see who might nab the coveted crown.
Yeah, and we'll be reviewing today's World Cup opener.
Okay. We're in Tommy and Alan are back tomorrow from 7 a.m.
Well, I've done a bit of the Nutcracker. I think I've cracked my nuts and I need to go and see somebody to get it sorted. Anyway, let's see it.
Mental images
go to social media.
Go to social media to look at your... Oh, God, well, stop. Right. Bye.
Bye.